Good evening, everybody. We just want to pray before we get started. Just thank you for coming. Thank you for this awesome worship team. It's also to set the atmosphere, so you guys can just join us in prayer. Lord, we just thank you for this evening, and we just welcome you into this place, God. We know it is because of you that we are here, so we just humble ourselves today, Lord God, and we just ask that you will be in this place with us. We ask right now that you will just touch our leaders, Pastor Chris and Angela Galsey, as they are out, Lord. We just thank you right now that as they are ministering, Lord God, that there will be miracles, signs, and wonders. So we just lift them up to you right now, Lord God, and we just thank you for the opportunity to be in the house while our pastors are on assignment. We plead the blood of Jesus upon our worship team and every leader and every member of this church. We thank you right now that tonight will be a night full of miracles, signs, and wonders. And God, we welcome you into this place. We thank you that every time we show up here at the assembly, you visit us. So God, we thank you that tonight is no different, Lord. We thank you that the worship will go to another level. And we thank you that the word will not fall on deaf ears, Lord God. So we just lift up a praise to you today, Lord God, and say, have your way in spirit of love. We thank you right now, Father. Whatever you want to do, do in this place, because you have the liberty. So we glorify you and we honor you, Lord. And we come against Satan and his plan to stop the word, to stop the worship. We are here today, Lord God. So we come into your presence with thanksgiving. And then we come into your presence with praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Come on, can we stand up to our feet? Because we're going to give God some praise tonight. Come on, you ready? Come on, let's go. God is so good to be here for him today. He's been awesome. He's been amazing. Come on, we're going to give God the highest praise tonight.
Jesus, say, Waymaker,
Waymaker,
you're the same.
Thank you. this place. We think that everything is changing.
Yeah. we are going to worship you, God, because you are so worthy and you are so holy, God. You are worthy, you are worthy. You are worthy, you are worthy.
Oh, I don't have the time to turn it off and praise you.
Come on, we're fighting out, say, holy,
We praise you. Even in business,
The people you rarely see in the shadow of things run. Take, for instance, restaurants or Disney. The front of the house where people see is glamorous. I've never been to Disney, but I can only imagine. You go there, you see Mickey Mouse, you see everybody running around. It's glorious. It's an experience. It's very pretty, very beautiful. But who knows what happens behind the scenes? Now, I've worked in many restaurants, and whether it's a five-star restaurant, you come in, there's a beautiful ambience, everybody's seated, white tablecloth. But you go to the back and it's a mess. It's chaotic. Things are being flown around everywhere. So my point is, every person is important for the vision of the house or business, or marriage, or family, or so on. So no matter who you are or where you find yourself, keep working because your position is tailor-made for you. Even in sports, often in football, the defensive players or the linemen aren't as popular as the quarterback or the running back or wide receiver. I mean, you think about how many linemen names you hear called. We all know the star quarterback. We all know the wide receiver or the running back. But what about those big 300, 400-pound guys who block the quarterback every single game? We rarely hear their names. But I guarantee you, if they're not there, we're going to notice. So my point is, their position is as important to the team as the quarterback, especially because they protect the star player, just like your role protects the anointing. That's good. When I first started ministry, I just wanted to help. I started vacuuming, sweeping, taking out trash, whatever you need, Pastor, whatever you need. So God began to tell me, play your position. Preparation time is never wasted time. Those small tasks that I was doing that seemed like it was nothing was really preparing me for where God has me now. Your role protects the anointing of the house, and when the team wins and gets a ring, they all win. So imagine those linemen who never get their name called, but when they win the Super Bowl, they still get a ring. They still get that nice salary. And a lot of them get to go out and be regular people and not have the hassle of everybody looking at them. My point is, every position matters in the body of Christ. So whether you're taking out the trash, whether you're on a praise and worship team, whether you're audiovisual, whether you're in the back with the children, every position matters. And here's what I'm going to tell you. You are important, and God knows where you are. Just because you find yourself in the back, or just because you find yourself doing something that you think is meaningless, God knows exactly where you are. And if you look at 1 Samuel 16, God looks into the heart. And I'm going to read the Message version. God addressed Samuel. So how long are you going to mope over Saul? So what's happening is Saul is rejected as king. And what God wants to do is God wants to anoint another king. So follow with me. God says, you know I've rejected him as king over Israel. Fill your flask with anointing oil and get going. I'm sending you to Jesse of Bethlehem. I've spotted the very king I want among your sons. So God is telling Samuel to go somewhere because he's getting ready to anoint the king, but God doesn't give them the exact instructions, and that's what God does with us. He'll tell us to go, but he won't give us instructions until we get there. So one, we see obedience is very, very necessary when God places you in a position. Samuel, like us, is going to tell God exactly what he can't do instead of just going. He says, I can't do that, said Samuel. Saul will hear about it and kill me. God said, take a heifer with you and announce, I've come to lead you in worship of God with the heifer as a sacrifice. Make sure Jesse gets invited. I'll let you know what to do next. You see, then again, God gives an instruction, and then the first thing we usually do as people of God or whatever is tell God why we can't do what he's called us to do. Then God begins to come back and say, oh, when you go, I'll have something ready for you. Here's what I'm going to do. Again, go. So God's making a plan, but he's not telling him everything. I'll let you know what to do next. Just get there. God's kind of like a parent. He's like, I told you just to do it. Don't question me. I'll tell you what you need to do when you get there. I'll point the one out you are to anoint. Samuel did what God told him. When he arrived at Bethlehem, the town fathers greeted him, but apprehensively. Is there something wrong? Nothing's wrong. I've come to sacrifice this heifer and lead you in worship of God. Prepare yourselves. Be consecrated and join me in worship. He made sure Jesse and his sons were also consecrated and called to worship. When they arrived, Samuel took one look at Eliab and thought, here he is, God's anointed. Now this is where I want to go. Samuel doesn't know exactly who God wants to anoint. God has told him to go. So as soon as Samuel got there, in his eyes, he's looking at the biggest person there. He doesn't even ask God, is this it? He gets there and says, this must be it, God. This must be him. A lot of times we do that. But God told Samuel, looks aren't everything. Don't be impressed with his looks and stature. I've already eliminated him. So Saul's like, he's big, he's beautiful, he's handsome, he's strong. God, this must be our next king. This must be the anointed one. God's like, no, son, I don't work that way. I've already eliminated him. God judges persons differently than humans do. Men and women look at the face. God looks into the heart. Jesse then called Abinadab and presented him to Samuel. Samuel said, this man is a God's choice either. So here's the picture I'm painting. He's there, and he's bringing all the sons up before him. And God's literally telling him, is this the one or not? So he's bringing seven sons before him. Next, Jesse presented Shammah. Samuel said, no, that's not him either. Jesse presented his seven sons to Samuel. Samuel was blunt with Jesse. God hasn't chosen any of these. Then Jesse asked, is this it? If God sent me here to anoint the son, and you told me none of these sons are it, there must be somebody else. He said, is there anyone else? Are there any more sons? Well, yes, the runt. Now, mind you, this is his dad. Yeah, there's the little runt, the little one. He in the back, but don't worry about him, because all my sons are here, they're strong, they're beautiful. This must be the king. Samuel ordered Jesse, go get him. We're not moving from this spot until he's here. How many of you know that's what God does with us? We look at ourselves as a runt. We look at ourselves as too small. We look at ourselves as insignificant. But God's like, I'm not moving until you get in position. You are the exact one I want, but you're back there thinking you're insignificant. God knew exactly where he was, and you see, they could not move until he was called. We're not moving from this spot until he's here. Jesse sent for him. He was brought in. The very picture of health, bright-eyed, good-looking. God said, up on your feet, anoint him. This is the one. Samuel took his flask of oil and anointed him, with his brother standing and watching. The Spirit of God entered David like a rush of wind, God vitality empowering him for the rest of his life. So the first thing God did, like I said, was give an instruction. God always has a plan. He made sure Jesse was invited, and he didn't tell the whole plan. He just needed an obedient vessel. Jesse's sons were invited. They were consecrated and called to worship. But Samuel again stepped ahead of God and tried to go by the flesh. So, of course, we see after Jesse passed all his sons, you know, he asked them, were they there? But the point I'm making is the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. And David went from sheep to replacing Saul. David went from the pasture to the palace. So what I'm telling you is, God won't leave you where he found you. God will never leave you where he found you. Now, mind you, he's sitting there minding his business, little, minding the sheep. He didn't even get invited, but that's exactly who God wanted. Now, here's another scripture I want us to look at. It's in Esther 2:12. Esther in her process of purification. Now, we see in this verse, each young woman's turn to come to the king in Ahasuerus after she had completed 12 months of preparation. So according to the regulations of the women, they would have, it says, for thus were the days of preparation appointed. They had to go 6 months with myrrh and oil and 6 months with perfumes and preparations for beautifying women. So before a girl's turn to come into King Xerxes' presence, she had to complete 12 months of beauty treatments prescribed for the women. And we see that's preparation. How many of us will go through that much preparation just to be a bride or just to be anointed? And lastly, I want to show Joseph in Genesis 41 through 46. Joseph in the process from the pit to the palace. Again, my point is preparation time is never wasted time. In Genesis 41:46, we learn that Joseph was 30 when he was made overseer to the king of Egypt. So since he was 17 when he was sold into Egypt, that means he spent 13 years total in Potiphar's house and in prison. So we know Joseph was in prison for at least 2 years, because chapter 40 tells us about the servants of the king whose dreams Joseph interpreted. The first verse of chapter 41 tells us that 2 years passed after that event before the king had the dream that Joseph was called to interpret. He was 17 when he was sold into Egypt, and he was 30 when he was made overseer. That's a long period of time that God was preparing him. Now, a lot of times we see how people shout about the life of Joseph and how amazing Joseph was, and I want to be like Joseph, or I want to be like David. But what I want you to see is the preparation it takes to get to those positions. Don't despise the times God's preparing you. Because a lot of times we shout over the anointing, we shout over the blessings, we shout over the beautification of it, but we don't shout about the process that it takes. Nobody shouts when they're in a prison. Nobody shouts when it's painful. Nobody shouts when they're hidden. Joseph told his brothers about a dream, and his dad made him a colorful robe with cross colors. No, I mean many colors, sorry. Some of y'all are older, but yeah. Some of y'all younger don't know what cross colors is. Yeah. David had a coat of cross colors. But he was sold into slavery, and he was a personal servant, and wrongly accused of rape, and thrown into prison. Even in that, he was faithful. A lot of us would have quit then. You tell your brothers about a dream, and they throw you into a pit. Then you get sold into slavery. Then in slavery, you're wrongly accused of rape, and you're thrown into a prison. Yet, when you're put into prison, you're ministering to men there. How many of us can do that? I guarantee you, a lot of you, if you're like me, you're going to be in that prison crying, weeping, moping, God, get me out of here. This man is even faithful in the prison and ministering to the people in the prison. And once he interpreted the prisoner's dreams, he became ruler over Egypt. And here's the kicker. He helped the very people who caused him harm. When I mean to tell you God's preparing you, sometimes you really have to be understanding of what that preparation looks like. God will prepare you in such a way where it looks like hurt, it looks like pain. Sometimes preparation looks like prison. Sometimes preparation looks like hurt. Sometimes preparation looks like heartache. Sometimes preparation looks like divorce. Sometimes preparation looks like a loss. Sometimes preparation looks like a pit. Sometimes preparation will have you crying your eyes out. God, what is happening? What is going on? I committed my life to you. I'm trying to live for you. But it seems like the closer I get to you, the more things are taken away from me. The closer I get to you, the more things begin to happen bad for me. I confess you as Christ. I said I want to live for you. But now my family and friends are looking at me because I'm begging for money or because I'm going through things that they're going through. God, I'm supposed to be a man of God, a woman of God, so why does my preparation look like a pit, look like a loss? But I'm here to tell you, preparation time is never wasted time.
Yes, sir.
Here's the thing. Preparation looks different for all of us. It's never the same. God prepared both me and my beautiful wife for each other. To be transparent, many of you know my story. Was married for 16 years, loving God, doing everything I could, 3 beautiful children, then you get a divorce out of nowhere. So my question is, God, where are you now? All I knew was my family. Now I'm divorced and ripped apart and don't know what the heck is going on. But God, something inside of me said, you know what, I'm still going to trust you. I went my own way for a while, to be honest, but I said, God, I'm going to trust you with this because I know too much about you. This, even this is preparation. Lo and behold, years later, whatever, I meet my beautiful wife. And I'm honest when I tell you this is the best marriage I've ever had. This is my best friend. This is my partner. So when I look at it in hindsight, God was preparing me for where I am now. It didn't look good, and it sure enough didn't feel good, but that preparation time was never wasted time. Because those times of praying, those times of frustration and going through prepared me to be the man that I needed to be for her and her preparation as well. So when it was time, when I met her, I did not question God. I got to the point where I said, God, you have to send my wife. When she came into my life, I just accepted her. I didn't have to pray. I didn't have to question it because God, you prepared me to be a husband. So once you send her, I'm just going to receive her. That's what we need to do. Let God develop you now for where you are going. Let me say that again. Let God develop you now for where you are going. Preparation time is never wasted time. It's too late to prepare when God brings you there. Imagine if you get to a place and then you find out you're not ready. And then God, now you're trying to get prepared for a situation you're in. That's too late. God is preparing you now for where you're going, so that way when you get there, you can just step right in. I have story after story after story of when God was preparing me, and I didn't understand it because it hurt, and it didn't make sense in my natural mind. But then he shifted me to another job or shifted me to a situation, and I said, oh, that what happened back there was for this moment. I know exactly what to do because I've been divorced, so I can speak into this person's life. I've raised in this neighborhood so I can speak into this young person's life. I've been hurt before, so I know what this feels like. Imagine if I'm ministering to somebody and they're telling me something, and I'm like, wait a minute. God, what do I do? I've never been here before. I'm not prepared. I'm not ready. My friend is here, so he'll know exactly what I'm talking about. I'm going to tell a story about South Park when I was a third shift security officer. I love stories because this is how God prepares me. There was a time where I'm fresh out of Bible college, and I'm thinking I'm the mini black Rob Parsley. Literally, like, you go to World Harvest Bible College, you go to World Harvest Church, I promise you, something gets on you where you're just going to lay hands and scream at people. I apologize to my family now. I will go to their house and literally, everybody's going to hell. Get your life right. Stop smoking. Stop drinking. Bible college, you have this anointing, you have everything, you're going through, but then God sets you back in the same place where you were. And I was confused. I said, God, if you anointed me, you called me, you appointed me, you're going to send me to the nations, yada, 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 I'm a third shift security officer. I'm bored. I'm tired. I'm sitting here every single day, and I'm supposed to be used. And I'm walking down, just doing my tours. And it's something about the voice of God when you yield yourself and he begins to speak to you. In third shift, there's nobody else around, so I can't even pretend that it's somebody else talking to me. I know it's God, and I'm crazy. So I'm complaining. I'm like, God, I'm supposed to be used. And God, you called me. I'm anointed, whatever. But I feel like I'm just stuck. I don't know what else to do. Do I open a church? Do I do a Bible study? What? God begins to speak to me. He says, Lamar, I want you to do something. I'm like, he's like, look at that palette. I said, okay, this is a pallet of paper, and it's on a ream. He's like, look at that. What's the difference between that one and the one that's in the machine? I'm having this conversation with God. I said, God, there is no difference. That one's just being used right now. He said, say that again. I said, there is no difference. That one's just being used right now. He said, exactly. He said, when this paper runs out, I'm going to come grab this one because it's prepared and it's ready to go. I know exactly where it's at. He said, I can come at any moment and use this paper as long as it doesn't move. So I'm sitting here now like, okay, that makes sense. But I'm still a little frustrated. So then I sit down, and he's still speaking to me. So he's going. I'm like, God, I said, I got it. But he's like, no, I want to show you something else. So there is this machine that wraps the pallet. It's like a big circle, and it just goes, it spins. So I'm looking at it, and God's speaking to me. And he's like, look at that. Once I take that pallet off the shelf, I know what's in it, and I'm spinning this paper around in a circle like crazy. Why would I do that? I said, I don't know. He's like, because I'm packaging it. And to you, it looks like it's going out of control. To you, it looks like everything's crazy. To you, it looks like it's spinning way too fast. But he said, to me, I'm taking that shrink wrap and I'm protecting my investment. What I place inside of it cannot be lost, cannot be damaged. So I'm spinning it so I can wrap it so that when I take it from this place to that place, what I've deposited in it will not shift or will not move when I take it from point A to point B. So now I begin to see God deposited something in me, but then placed me back in a seemingly dry place to see how I would respond to that. While I think nothing's happening, God's like, something's happening. I just need you to wait while I prepare you a little bit more. So I begin to see how my night seasons were developing me to pray and study and hear from God. So now when I begin to go to work as a third shift security officer, I started to pray for people. I started to use that time wisely. Like, okay, I could watch Netflix all night, I could watch these movies, but now something's starting up with me. Like, God's been preparing me, so I need to be prepared. I was looking for promotion instead of looking for God. I wanted something quick. I thought as soon as God laid me out, I was ready. As soon as God calls me to the altar and touches me and I fall out, when I get back up, I'm ready for ministry. But God's like, a lot of times, That's just preparation. And that's what happens with us. We get called to the altar, we get knocked out, we get a prophetic word, and then we want to run straight out and do ministry, but we get attacked more. Or we have hell break loose, and we don't understand what's going on. But God's like, that's part of the preparation. Another story I want to share is when I was in Texas, and now I moved to Texas and I began to speak at a conference. So I finally get out of that third shift security position and God moves me. So now I'm like, okay, God, you're using me. As I'm speaking, this girl walks in and she begins to tell me, God spoke to her and told her she needed to be in my class because she needed to hear what I had to say. I began to share my story about the third shift security guard and questioning God and how I was teaching this course. And what I want you to see is sometimes we fail to see how the seasons we complained about were actually the very thing that God prepared us for.
Come on.
The very things we're complaining about are the very things God's going to use in your next season. So someone needs to hear how you made it out. And this is what God began to show me. He said, Lamar, a lot of times people talk about the success. People talk about the money. They talk about the anointing. The story of my life is struggle, struggle, struggle. When I begin to share my struggle, people get set free. When I begin to share my struggle, people understand that there is a God who will take you through a struggle, but will never leave you. So as I'm going through the struggle, now I realize in my life, God, this struggle is preparing me. This struggle is making something come up in me. This struggle is developing something in me that I couldn't do for myself. So I want you to understand right now, your struggles are just victories on their way. Share your struggles, not just your victories. Because a lot of times in the body of Christ, we share how we made it over, or we share what God is doing great. But some people need to hear how you struggle. Some people need to hear how you were hurt, how you were broke, how you were divorced, how you almost had this and almost had this happen. Because that's when they begin to see even Christians struggle. But they have hope. Even Christians go through the exact same thing I go through. But maybe that's why they pray so much. Maybe that's why they begin to shout to Jesus. Maybe that's why they hit their knees and cry. Because the struggle didn't break them. The struggle made them stronger. The struggle didn't break them. The struggle gave them a boldness to begin to speak the word. The struggle will put you in a position to where you either crumble or you begin to be victorious. And that's what I want to share with you today. When we don't see progress fast enough, learn to wait while God works. That's the only reason I share these stories, is to give you insight on how God will develop you. Another story I have is, as I was arriving at church, I had to wait for the service to end. Now, this was a huge mega church, and as you know, sometimes you pull up and there's no places to park. So as I waited in line to park, I was stopped by the parking lot attendant. And I was a bit irritated, but I waited because I had no choice. He told me to wait for about 1 minute while people began to leave. And as I waited, God spoke to me. Sometimes I will make you wait so I can make room for your blessing. As you wait, I am working. Now, that's the beautiful thing about God. When you yield yourself to His Spirit, He'll talk to you about things that seem minute, things that seem like it don't make sense. I'm in a parking lot going on my way to church, and God is speaking to me about parking spaces. He said, as you're waiting, you pull up and there's no parking spots. I make you wait. And now you have options. As I waited, cars began to exit and many parking spaces became available. And it went from being filled and full with no room to me having options. So what I want to tell you is God is moving things in your favor as you wait. A lot of you are waiting on something, and it may be months, it may be years. You feel like, God, why am I waiting? Why is this taking so long? Rest assured that while you're waiting, God is moving. And once that spot begins to open, a lot of times you're not even worried about how long it took. The wait seems like it takes forever until you get what you want. Then all of a sudden, it doesn't seem that long. Amen. God is moving things in your favor as you wait. You will have open doors and options. You just have to wait a bit while God works.
Yes.
I just feel like that's just a mother. You know, mothers are cooking and there's always kids or boys in the kitchen wanting to taste something, or a greedy husband wants to grab something. And she's like, get out the kitchen. Like, it's not ready yet. God is working. God is cooking something. God is doing something in your favor. So just be patient as you wait. Another scripture I want to go to is Isaiah 40:31 in the Message. This Message Bible will mess you up. I mean, it's one thing when you read something in a translation, but when I read this scripture in this translation, it blew my mind. It says, why would you ever complain, O Jacob, or whine, Israel, saying, God has lost track of me. He doesn't care what happens to me. Don't you know anything? Haven't you been listening? God doesn't come and go. God lasts. He's creator of all you can see or imagine. He doesn't get tired out. He doesn't get tired out, doesn't pause to catch his breath. And he knows everything, inside and out. He energizes those who get tired. He gives fresh strength to dropouts. For even young people tire and drop out. Young folk in their prime stumble and fall. But those who wait upon God get fresh strength. They spread their wings and soar like eagles. They run and don't get tired. They walk and don't get lagged behind. That's what I want you to know. You serve a God who doesn't get tired. Yes, we get tired. Yes, we get weary. Yes, we complain. Yes, we get frustrated. Yes, we go through hurts and pains. But when you understand the type of God you serve, in a moment, in an instant, he can drop down your answer. He can drop your blessings. He can change your situation. Trust me when I say waiting, waiting, waiting doesn't feel good. But when that promise comes, you will not be worried about how long it took.
That's right. That's right.
Your worth isn't determined by where you are right now. Then I'm going to do something. Please forgive me, but Ty, if I can have you up here, I promise I'm not going to have you speak. But as I was going over this word, I kept seeing your face, and I want to just acknowledge her publicly. How old are you? How old are you?
13.
Now, I've been very honest. Every week when I come in here, just her voice, just her spirit.
Yes.
And the fact that I work with teenagers as a teacher, and I see some of the craziest things in high school, it's so refreshing to have a 13-year-old like you up here worshiping.
Yes, 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 yes.
So what I want to say is your worth isn't determined by where you are right now. You're already valuable to God. Now, I'm going to do this, and this is what God told me to do, but I want you to, what is this? $20, okay. Now, track with me. If I do this to it, would you still want it? So I can crumble it up.
What
if I do this? What if I rip it? Would you still want it? Okay. What if I do this? Would you still want it? Why? This $20 bill has been ripped. It's been crumbled. It's been stepped on. I can move it from hand to hand to hand. What God wants to tell you is it doesn't matter what you go through, you still have value.
Yes.
He still wants it. And I step on
it.
This is yours.
Right.
I had that illustration, but this is yours.
Right,
right. Again, just think about that. That was a weird illustration. No matter where I move that money, it still has value. The value of the money never changes, just the position of the money. We have money in our hands all the time. So you see, I can tear it, I can crumble it, I can ball it up, I can get it dirty, but I guarantee someone will still want it. Why? Because no matter what I put it through, it still has value. And that's what I'm going to drive home to you today. No matter what you have been through, no matter what you have gone through, you still have value. A lot of times we think our value is based upon what we've been through, but you are exactly who God wants. God wants the people who've been through something. God wants the people who have a story. He doesn't want picture perfect. He doesn't want somebody who has it all together. God wants the people who've been thrown away, who's been cast away, who's been put in jail, who's been through something. When you are going through, when are you going to begin to see your worth? When are you going to begin to see your worth? If she would take that $20 after all it's been through, how much more valuable are you to God? How much more valuable? Another illustration God showed me is when grapes are plucked from the vine and crushed to be used for wine, that's just the beginning of the process. It may take years before that wine is aged enough to enjoy. The plucking is just the beginning of the process. So many of you have already been plucked by God. You're in God's kingdom. You're in his hand. But you feel like, God, I'm still not being used. What am I here for? You plucked me. You took me. You saved me. But now I'm just sitting. Like me. I felt like I was just sitting. Is this all you called me to do, would just be saved and then that's it? Trust the process. The plucking is just the beginning of the process. Some grapes are plucked and used immediately. Sometimes they're plucked and they're instantly sent to the stores and people begin to devour them. But look at the ones that are worth a little bit more. Some grapes are plucked and then they're stepped on and then they're crushed and then they're pressed. And then after all of that process, they're put in a wine bottle, then they're stored for years. So imagine in a grape's mind, just track with me for a minute, imagine if there are a bunch of grapes, some get picked and immediately they're used. That's what happens to some of us. God takes us and boom, immediately you're used. Yeah. Immediately God begins to use you. God begins to do things to you. And you're looking like, wait a minute, we were plucked at the exact same time, but they were plucked and they're used, and I was plucked and I'm crushed. I've been stepped on. I've been beaten. I've been talked about. I have to go through something. And then after all that, you want to put me in a bottle and tell me to wait? After all of this, now I got to sit on the shelf. I'm not a wine connoisseur by any way, but how much does wine go for when it's aged?
Right.
Yes. I mean, people do some weird stuff. They open it up and they're like, whispers, you know. Think about it. They look at it. They don't even just pour it and drink it. They take it and they just. They don't drink at all. They just take a little sip. Then they just take a little sip. Chardonnay. I mean, it's like, but those are still grapes. So you think about that. Like, there was a process that those grapes had to go through.
Yes.
And throughout the whole process, they were stored. But how much more valuable are those grapes than the ones that were plucked and used immediately?
Yeah.
So what I'm trying to get you is don't be in a rush to be used by God.
Right.
Or don't complain about the season he has you in, because maybe your waiting is in hallelujah. Maybe your waiting is increasing your value.
Yeah.
Maybe your waiting is releasing something stronger in you. Maybe your waiting is for something else greater in you. And God said, no, you wait, because I'm putting you in position.
Yeah.
I know what I have right now, but I know where you are. And this is what I want to speak to. I heard the Spirit say, just because you're not being used right now doesn't mean you're valuable. And the important thing about waiting is you have to stay in position.
Yes.
What I thought about that South Park when I was in that place, if someone was to move that pallet when they came to look for it, then it would never be used. Sometimes we move too quickly because we get frustrated. God will say, hey, I deposited something in you. I brought you to the altar. I poured something in you. Now I want you to sit over here and wait. But we get antsy. Because we see everybody around us being used. We see everybody around us getting blessed. We see everybody around us doing something great. And we're like, God, it must be me. Or God, it must be my church. Or God, it must be something else going on. And God's like, no. I told you to just wait. Because there's a process in waiting. There's an anointing in waiting.
Yeah.
God's like, can I trust you? Maybe it's not so much about God, but about what he wants you to do in that waiting. Will you say in my word? Will you keep praying? Will you be able to just be home and sit?
Right.
Because when God comes back for you, he knows you exactly where you are.
Yeah.
And if you move too prematurely, then you won't be used. Let God develop you where you are so you will be prepared for where you are going. Now, please don't laugh, don't judge me. I've had about 75 different jobs in my life, and I'm going to touch more. But I'm going to just name a few because this is part of the message. Grocery bagger and cart retriever. Thanks, Mom. She made me go to Meijer in the snow, push carts, like, put you on last. Dead winter blizzard. I'm out there 14 years old pushing carts in the snow. Well, Meijer carts even out in the snow. Pizza delivery man, warehouse worker, operating room assistant, school teacher, marriage and family counselor, security officer, manager, minister, author, speaker. What do all of these have in common? These are just a few of the many positions of servanthood that I have had the pleasure of having over the course of my life.
Yeah.
Now, to some of you, it may seem like I'm unstable and I don't know what I want to do in life and I just jump from job to job. But I guarantee you, every position I've ever had has prepared me for what I'm doing now.
Yeah.
When I was delivering pizzas, God would speak to me and I would want to be the best. I would want to be the fastest. I would want to bring the pizza to you the hottest.
Mm-hmm.
When I was in the operating room, God began to speak to me because I left Bible college. And I came back to the same hospital that I used to be an operating room assistant in when I was in ministry. And God said, hey, remember when I let you operate on these people?
Mm-hmm.
Now you're in here praying on them. Man, isn't it ironic that you know exactly what you're praying for? You can see it in their body.
Yes,
I knew what I was doing.
Amen. Yes.
Every job that I have had has taught me something. But what God began to show me was serving God through serving and loving people, it was less about my position and less about my situation and more about my character. If I would allow my job to determine who I was as a man of God or my position, then I would have missed what God was doing.
Right.
I never looked at the smallest job I had as meaningless because there was people that I met.
Yeah.
My brother's here right now because I met him on the job. Now, if I never was at that security officer position, I never would have met him. So when I tell you preparation time is never wasted time, sometimes where you're at is because God wants you there to minister to other people. Sometimes you're there because God is forging relationships. Sometimes you're there because God is teaching you how to humble yourself. Sometimes you're there because God is depositing something in you, or he wants you to deposit something in someone else. So I'm here to tell you preparation time is never, never wasted time. Lastly, I have about 45 stories on books. An elephant and a dog became pregnant at the same time.
Yeah.
3 months down the line, the dog gave birth to 6 puppies. 6 months later, the dog was pregnant again. And 9 months on, it gave birth to another dozen puppies. The pattern continued. On the 18th month, the dog approached the elephant questioning, "Are you sure that you are pregnant? How many of you are pregnant with something? How many of you are pregnant with purpose? How many of you are pregnant with something that God put in you?" And everybody around you is questioning. Even it seems like the world is going better than us sometimes. You're supposed to be a Christian, but you don't have a house. You're supposed to be a Christian, but your car keeps breaking down. You're supposed to be a Christian, but you go through health problems. You're supposed to be a Christian, you've been believing God for 45 years for the same thing, but you're still standing. There will always be somebody questioning what God is depositing in you. But rest assured, are you sure that you are pregnant? We became pregnant on the same day. I have given birth 3 times to a dozen puppies, and they are now grown to become big dogs. Yet you are still pregnant. What's going on?
Yeah.
Now, here's the beautiful part about this. The elephant had 2 options. If somebody's speaking to you like that and you don't know who you are, the elephant could have cried and said, "You know what? You're right. We were pregnant at the same time. You had 3, 6, 9 puppies, and I'm still pregnant. There must be something wrong with me, or there must be something wrong with God." But when you know who God is, and you know who you are, you know the power of preparation, then you can't be an elephant. That elephant replied, "There is something I want you to understand. What I am carrying is not a puppy, but an elephant. I only give birth to 1 in 2 years. When my baby hits the ground, the earth feels it. When my baby crosses the road, human beings stop and watch in admiration. What I carry draws attention." What I carry draws attention. That's what I want to tell you right now. What you carry draws attention. It doesn't matter how long it takes. It doesn't matter how long you've been pregnant. It doesn't matter how long people have seen you fail. And they're looking at you like, "What is going on?" You're believing. Your whole life you've been saying, "This God this and this God that." And it seems like you're struggling and everybody else is doing better than you. But when God begins to give birth to that thing, people begin to notice. People begin to see. Just like when Joseph, the same brothers that threw him in the pit were the same brothers that came to him asking him for help. And he had to humble himself and say, "God, don't lose faith when you see others receive answers to their prayers. Don't be envious of their testimony. If you haven't received your own blessing, don't despair. Say to yourself, my time is coming." Can you guys say that with me? My time is coming. "And when it hits the surface of the earth, people shall yield in admiration." And I'm closing. Carlos, can you just please play that song for me? What I want you to say, what I want you to remember, if you remember anything else, just play your position and remember, preparation time is never wasted time.
That's right.
God won't leave you where he found you. Once you pick something up, just imagine if there's something on the ground and you pick it up. Once you pick it up, it's in your possession and it goes everywhere you go. Once you pick something up, it's in your possession. That's what God does with you. He takes you right where you are and doesn't intend for you to stay the same. He loves you too much to leave you where you are.
How many people are grateful that he loved you too much to leave you where you are?
You don't have to come. I just want you to hear this song. If you need prayer for anything, if you feel the spirit of God and you say, "God, I want to dedicate my life," or you just want to worship, just use this time. But know that God's not going to leave you where he left you. anything to just come worship. Says, God, you saved me. You kept me. Thank you for being God. Yes. Hallelujah. So, Lord, I just thank you for your people today, and I thank you for this word. I plead the blood of Jesus upon them right now, and I just thank you that they will understand that there is power in waiting, that as they are waiting, that they are trusting you during the process. I thank you right now, Lord God, that you are preparing them for something greater, whether it is small or wherever they are at right now, whatever questions they have. I pray right now that they will learn to wait on you, Father, in the name of Jesus. We just give you glory for what you're doing and who you are in Jesus' name.